Hello everyone, so in our videos we were discussing about the problems related to the arrays, and till now we have seen 7 problems which are related to the arrays, and most of those problems came into previous year examinations of various companies. Now again in this video we are discussing about the problem which is again related to the array, but this problem is from Microsoft interviews. As you can see, the Microsoft interview. So from now onwards, whenever I'm going to discuss any problem, whether it is a easy level, whether it is a medium level, whether it is a hard level or any level, I'll also mention the name of the company where this problem was asked. Okay, at the same time I'm also going to mention you this problem, what are the technologies that is used to solve this problem. Again, the main aim is to solve the problem in the minimum time possible, or it's the most efficient solution that we need to find. Okay, now let me explain you the problem here. So in this video I'm just explaining what is the problem. Now then you have to stop, then you have to think about the problem, write a program to solve the problem and try to see if it is matching the constraints or not, and then in the next video I'm going to give you the solution of the same problem. Okay, so let us check out the problem first. So problem is like this: given an array, print all sub arrays in an array which has sum 0. For example, here we have an array like this. Okay, so let me draw it like this. This is the array, assuming it is having the values 6, 3, minus 1, minus 3, 4, minus 2, 2, 4, 6, minus 12, and we have minus 7. So this is the array we have. And we have the following index locations, which are 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, and 10. Okay, and this is array A. Now your aim is to find all the locations where all the subarrays of this array which is having the sum as 0. Now for example, here you can clearly see, if I take this subarray, I mean only this part of the array, this is a subarray. Okay, this can also be drawn like this. This is minus 2. And this is minus 2, and it, assuming it is array B, so this is the subarray of the given array. Okay, so this is a subarray of the given array. Now in this subarray, the sum of these numbers, which is minus 2 and plus 2, the sum is going to be 0, and because the sum is 0, that is why this subarray will be counted here. So we have to give the index locations of all the subarrays which are having the sum as 0. Okay. So as you can check here, how many subarrays like this existing in this problem. We have already written the outputs here, but you can still check it. We have a subarray here from 2 to 4. For example, from here to here, if you add all the numbers which are minus 1 plus of minus 3 plus of 4, so the sum is 0. This is a subarray whose sum is 0. We also have a subarray from index location 2 to 6. So from here to the index location number 6, this subarray, if I add the numbers, then it is minus 1 plus of minus 3 plus 4 plus minus 2 plus 2. So this subarray is having the addition sum as 0. In the same way, we have a subarray which is 5 to 6, already discussed it. Then we have subarray from 6 to 9. That means if we have from here to here, if you add all the numbers, they are 2 plus 4 plus 6 plus of minus 12. Now this subarray is also having the sum as 0, and at the same time this entire array can also be having a sum 0, right? For example, from 0 to 10, so this entire array is also having the sum 0, which is from 0 to 10. Now there can be various variations of the same problem. What are those variations? For example, they can say, instead of giving the sum as 0, we can ask whether there exists a subarray of an array where the sum is actually equivalent to x. Instead of 0, I can change the problem, and I can also ask, does there exist a subarray of a given array whose sum is actually equivalent to x? Okay, so that is again a variation of this problem that you can solve here. Okay, now the program that you are going to write, because we have to write the functions here. So as you can see in the previous videos, I have given the input constraints. That is, whenever you have to write a function to solve a certain problem, then what is the way the user is going to give you the input, and then they'll also give you the output. I mean, you have to give the output in their format, because generally what happens is the outputs of these programs are not checked by individuals, but rather there are sophisticated programs who checks whether the input, whatever input they give, then what is the output that you are going to get. At the same time, those programs also check that you should follow the time constraints or time complexity analysis. For example, they'll follow that for any given problem, so whatever solution that you are going to give, that solution should be time efficient. Okay, for that the time constraints are also embedded, so the solutions are accepted only when they follow the time constraint. Secondly, the solution should be perfect, or you can say the solution should be correct. And third, your programming methodology or how cleanly you write the program, that also matters. Okay, so all these three things are really important while you are solving the problems related to these examinations. Okay, or you can say related to these companies. Fine. So the input is given this way. The first line of the input contains the integer t, denoting the number of test cases. For example, if we have the first line as 2, right, in the input, that means we are going to give two test cases. Okay, so there can be a first case test case here, then we have a second test case here. So this is telling you what is the input format they have to give, and then they'll also tell you what is the output format that you have to give. Okay, so I've not specified the output format here, I've just written an example output here, but output format is also specified, that so that the other programs that they will write to check the solutions, they should also be able to, you know, verify that your output is correct or not. So generally what happens is they take around 1000 to 1000 test cases. In most of the cases, the huge number of test cases that they take, and they generate an output file for all those test cases. And when you submit the program, there are other programs which work on this program to get the output, and those outputs are matched with the correct output files. Okay, so here we have two test cases, and the second line contains right, and then first line of each test case contains an integer n, denoting the size of the array. For example, if I say the size of the array is 11, okay, so the first line is number of test cases, second line is the size of the array, and the third line here in this one will be the n space separated integers, which is denoting the array itself. For example, here the array is 6, 3, minus 1, minus 3, 4, minus 2, 2, 4, 6, minus 12, and 7. So all these numbers are space separated. Okay, in the same way, because we have taken two test cases, that is why after this the second test case will begin, where let us say the number is 5, where 5 is denoting the size of the array, and let us say the array is 4, minus 2, minus 2, 4, and 6, and it is denoting the array. So these are two input scenarios, two test cases that we have given, and after this your solution will also be matched. Okay, I hope that you understood the problem. Now stop here, write a program to I've already given you the assignments, right? I've already given you the PDF file of the assignments. Stop here, write the program, find out your solution, and then come back to the next video where I'm just giving you the solution of these problems. Okay, I hope that you understood this one. Let us move on to the next video now. Thank you so much for watching.